Theresa Duringer, and I am a founder at Temple Gates Games, making VR games and board games. So Cannon Brawl was my first indie game, and before that I worked at EA Maxis, so I was working on Spore and SimCity and The Sims, and I worked on Godfather a little bit. I started out as a tester and put my dues in, and then I did community management, which was really fun, and then I did production, and then I left doing software engineering.
Wow, yeah. That's a lot of different skill sets.
Which is why I went indie, because then you can kind of merge all of that and it makes sense.
On Cannon Brawl as well, you were doing all of the art, right?
Yeah.
So you really are a master of all trades here.
Yeah, sure.
Well, either you're a master of all trades or you've got no patience. Why are you doing VR now?
Because I needed to add one more thing because I didn't have enough already. No, I think VR was, as a designer, it's kind of really exciting because it's a really uncharted territory.
Right.
But also there's been, I'm sure like you hear about all the time, but there's been a big shift in what's going on in the indie scene. And so I think I was sort of struggling with how to set myself apart, and I saw VR as an opportunity to try something new and take a risk, and so that's kind of what got me into it, and then I've been really happy with it since then.
So has the indie scene just, is it a case of there's just a lot more people in it right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's sort of like a two-pronged system that is fundamentally shifted what it is to be indie, and part of that is coming from the tools that are available now. So you have like Unity, so you can get a lot more people. There's a lot more accessibility with making games, and there's just a lot more people making them. And then you have Steam for publication, which has just taken off, and Steam Greenlight. There's just been so many games there. And then you also have the university system that is churning out a lot of game development focused graduates who are all coming into this market. And a lot of the people that are indie now, I'm seeing a lot of people are students who are trying to make this game that is going to land them their first industry job.
Right.
So it's not necessarily what it used to be, which was like a lot of people who were leaving AAA to try to get creative control. So that's just changed things quite a bit.
Right. So it's almost like graduates are leaving now and their way of building their portfolio to get them their gig is actually just doing indie work.
Yeah, because either you can just get a job, but you know, there's only so many jobs. If you don't get a job, you can just say, I'm indie and be working on games anyways, and then that will be a stepping stone towards a job if you can prove that you can make something really cool.
Was Cannon Brawl like a little bit bittersweet in a way? Because to me, that was a game that I feel like I adored it. It was one of my favorite games that came out that year. But it did seem to have a visibility problem.
Yeah, I think a big part of that was it was our first indie game. Mm. So a lot of like the indie games that I think people think of as these like really core monumental indie games are not the creators. They're not necessarily always the creator's first game. And the indie community is so like mutually supportive of itself. And so I think when someone establishes themselves and puts themselves out there and continues to contribute content to the scene, people lift them up. I mean, as an indie, you can't do your own marketing, really.
Right.
You have to rely on this community. And if nobody knows who you are, because it's like really your first sort of time, I think that can affect you. So I think we did suffer because we were kind of no names on the scene when we made Cannon Brawl. But people know us now. And Pete, my partner on Cannon Brawl, just did a Kickstarter, and he's been really successful with that. So I think, you know, having already done Cannon Brawl, people are like, okay, you know, this kid has something, well, he's not a kid anymore, but something really cool to offer. So I think it just takes a little bit of perseverance. In VR, I love doing a lot of UI, and in VR there's this sort of like promise of, you know, like Minority Report. There's just like, you could create all this cool future stuff, and it could be anywhere, and it could be overlapping, and it could be like holographic, and the status quo hasn't been really established. And so that is one thing I've been really excited about in VR. But it's also really tricky because there's just I feel like every time you try to do something in VR, it takes like 10 failures to make something work. So it just takes a lot of time. So Bazaar it's a flying carpet adventure, and it was mostly like an experiment in just doing VR itself. So it's a game that my friends and I made for the Oculus VR Jam, and then we ended up being winners, and I'm really proud of it. I thought it was really cool.
What are some of the biggest lessons you learned from creating that? Like stuff that you had no idea about before, and now you're like, God, of course.
There's so many. Oh man, I was saying that VR has all this promise and opportunity for new things. So I had initially designed this user interface that was in the stars. Okay. So it was like your inventory was literally a constellation like above you. So if you wanted to grab your bow and arrow, you would look at the bow and arrow constellation once you'd gotten it. And it was so pretty, it was so cool. Everything's like sparkling and glittering, and you'd get this, like, your mini map was like this dendritically growing structure in the sky. But the problem was nobody is comfortable looking up that much. Like, you'd right. play and you'd be doing this, and that just really hurts your neck.
Who knew?
I know. So it's like, that was pretty terrible. So I had to redo all of that, and I ended up putting the inventory in a box Aww. On your carpet, which, the thing is, it's like really obvious, so everyone understands how to use it, and there's something to be said for that. And then I put this sort of, I left the sky stuff as kind of an Easter egg. If you look up to the sky, you can kind of get this almanac, kind of like Spelunky style of everything you've encountered, but you don't ever need to. So there was a lot of gotchas like that. Ascension, it's a tabletop game, and it's a deck builder. In VR, there's such a cool opportunity to bring people who want to play board games together in a space and play those board games, even if they don't have friends near them who can play the board games with them. There's an immediate difference of just stepping into the fantasy world of like what your board game, the setting of it is. You can create that all around you, and that's like this magical thing. But the lasting difference is the social stuff. So, like being able to make eye contact with someone. Also, you can pay attention to where someone's looking to see what they're focusing on. So like, if I'm playing a digital game, a board game with someone, and I'm like on my phone or on my tablet, it's kind of sometimes kind of boring between turns because you don't even know if they've stepped away from the game. Like a lot of people play asynchronously for this reason. In VR, you can really see them making the decisions. You can see like literally where they're looking between the game pieces. And it kind of lets you take the turn with them, like just like in real life. Like if we were playing a board game in real life and you're taking your turn and you're kind of taking a while, like maybe you've got some analysis paralysis going and you're like looking between these things that you want to do, I can see where you're looking and I can kind of like appreciate the gravity of whatever decision you're making. And that's just really interesting. And that's something we have in VR that we haven't had ever before.
Do you find that because people can make eye contact and there is that sort of that localized environment that you get less just griefing and things like that? I mean, that's kind of built into VR already because the bar to get into VR is already at a stage where people are kind of less asshole-y by default. But like, do you find that people get on better with each other and stuff?
Yeah, I don't know that that applies like across applications, because I've heard a lot of interesting comments and observations that in VR you can get some really tricky stuff with like harassment and stuff like that. I think it's going to become a bigger problem as VR gets more adoption, so we'll all have to figure it out together.
Right.
That'll be fun.
Tell me a little bit about your flights.
I have a really huge problem with flying. It's aviophobia, and I just get really nervous when I'm flying, and I like break out in hives, and I can't talk, and it's just like really, it's probably really uncomfortable for the people around me too, but like it's really awful. Like leading up to a flight, I won't be able to sleep for like nights just knowing I have to fly. So
has it been like that since you were a kid?
No, it just like came out of nowhere. I don't know what the heck happened. It's like maybe it's like an allergy or something. It just popped up. Yeah, like, I don't know, what, 5 years ago or something like that. And so I have been trying to experiment in VR with trying to make content that will help me distract me from being on a flight. I come from a psychology background, and I know with phobias, a lot of people try to deal with them. They try to tackle phobias with exposure therapy. The whole point of exposure therapy is so that when you're exposed to something, you can cope with it. But if you don't have to be exposed with something, like if you can remove the experience through something like VR, then maybe that's a solution in itself. So that's been what I've been trying to focus on is like, you know, you have the retinal monopoly in VR, you're not seeing the context of the flight around you. You can override the sounds of the airplane with the sounds of the game. So I've been playing with trying to make games that are engaging enough to offset the terror. Well, I first started noticing this effect when I was working on Bazaar, which was that first game, because I brought the game with me on a holiday trip just to kind of work while I was on a flight. And I noticed that there was an effect. Like, I noticed that, you know, an hour into VR, my hands that are usually totally like drenched in sweat because I'm so nervous were dry. And I thought that's pretty incredible. But the one thing that was actually kind of interesting was when I was on a flight and I was doing this VR stuff and I was playing Bazaar, I noticed that when the plane kind of lists to the side because it's making a turn, when you're on the plane and you're not in VR, you really don't appreciate the degree of angle that you're at, because your horizon line inside the airplane is still relative. Like, your body and your horizon line and everything stays kind of relative, so it feels very static. But in the plane has registered the sort of like origin, like, you know, XYZ, when you were flat probably. And so when you turn and you're in VR, because of the accelerometer informing your like game camera stuff, it actually is like a really accurate turn, and it exaggerates.
Oh my God.
The amount of turning. So that was a little bit of a opposite of what I was going for, learning thing. So yeah, we'll see. I'll keep working on it. See where it goes. Well, one thing I love is that, you know, there is potential to take the accelerometer data, you know, that reflects where you are at in the airplane or on a car or on a boat or whatever, and actually have a game that like incorporates that.
Wow.
I haven't seen anyone do it yet, but someone could, and that could be really cool. You know, one thing I would love to try is take data from when you're in turbulence and include something in the game, like a dinosaur like stomping around or something that accounts for the turbulence. Because I think that if you could kind of like explain something, like one of the things I think is the most scary about turbulence is a lot of times there's no visual that it's associated with. So it feels like this very like mysterious sort of force. It's almost like metaphysical feeling, because there's no sensory information that's gonna like predict it to me. Maybe like some clouds or something, but if you could tie that to something that would feel a little bit more explainable, maybe that would help with the anxiety. We'll see.
Go for it. Sorry, let me actually ask you the question. Go for it. God, what an awful thing
Plug
to fucking
yourself.
Say.
Best thing
yeah.
ever.
So if people want to pick up Ascension and play it themselves, where can they get it?
They can get it on Steam or the Oculus Store for Vive, Gear, and Rift. And you can follow our development blog if you want to find out about more cool stuff at templegatesgames.com.
Awesome. And the Twitch streams?
Those are Ascension_VR.